Welcome to the Cybersecurity Speaker Series, presented by NSA's Cybersecurity Collaboration Center. Our mission is to augment and amplify NSA's ability to prevent and eradicate threats to national security systems and the defense industrial base by establishing open, robust, and collaborative relationships across industry and government. Through bidirectional threat intelligence sharing and joint analytic tradecraft development, these partnerships leverage unique talents and capabilities to enhance cybersecurity across the nation. In this series, you'll hear about the work we do here and its real-world applications, bringing these insights to you through some of the top minds at NSA.
Hi, I'm Daley Bickley. I'm at the NSA Cybersecurity Collaboration Center, which is our home for public-private partnerships on cybersecurity. But another thing that's really important to us is not just preaching public-private partnerships, say that fast three times, but you know, actually practicing it and showcasing our work. And one of the ways that we do that is through the Cybersecurity Speaker Series and podcast, where we have various technical experts from across our community just share a little bit about what they've been up to. To that end, I'm thrilled to have two of my colleagues with me here today, and I'll turn it over to them to let them introduce themselves.
Thank you, Bailey. I'm Eric Chudow from NSA's Cybersecurity Publishing Organization. You might know us by our advisories that we put out on nsa.gov. We publish numerous of those every single year.
And my name is Peter Kalaramakis with MITRE Corporation. I lead the D3FEND project for MITRE and NSA, and I also work on various other research and development projects at MITRE.
And fun fact, the three of us have been working together for years, and this is our first time getting to meet in person due to COVID. So we're super excited about that. So, Peter, I want to start with you because, as I understand it, D3FEND is your baby. It's your brainchild. So can you talk to us a little bit about why it was developed and, you know, perhaps an unintended consequence? You know, you've now ended up on NSA YouTube.
Yeah, I guess I wasn't planning ending up on NSA YouTube, but that's fortuitous. So D3FEND has been a really fun project for us. You know, and even though D3FEND focuses...
Well, and what is it, first of all? Sorry to interrupt.
D3FEND is effectively a model for what cyber defenders are doing in their day-to-day activities, but it's trying to establish a common language for those activities. So even though D3FEND focuses a lot on technology, it's really solving a human problem, right? And getting everyone on the same page with a common language is essential for doing good analysis on your investments and building secure systems. Even though it's this really simple sort of meat and potatoes problem, it can have significant impacts because you can do all these secondary sorts of activities, which are going to be higher fidelity, higher accuracy in how you communicate with other people about cyber defensive technology.
So it's really MITRE ATT&CK flipped, as I understand it, or?
Right. Okay. So people in our field are quite familiar with MITRE ATT&CK. And the problem it was solving there is, again, the simple problem of getting people to use the same language. You know, how many times have you been in a meeting where you see people using the same word, but they actually mean different things, right? So when ATT&CK was pushed out, it got people on the same page as to what is the adversary actually doing. And then there's this sort of natural follow-up question, okay, as defenders, what do we actually do about that? And that's where we propose D3FEND in trying to establish that common language. One of the challenges there, of course, is you have to use a lot of like really specific terms to talk about cybersecurity technology. And those terms didn't really exist. So we had to kind of create those and define those. And so it's been really interesting because we've had to dig into a lot of these technologies, how they work under the hood, and try to bring them up and give them a name. What's it really doing, right, to the system?
Well, I think it's super cool. I think it's important work. And as you were talking, you know, a story kind of struck me. My background is in communications and marketing, and primarily in cybersecurity. And I'll never forget the first time I used the wrong term to describe something that was happening in cyber, and like 20 network defenders like jumped in my face and was like, ah, you know. So it's really important because nuances matter in cyber. And so having that consistent lexicon really is valuable. So Eric, I know that NSA funded this work. You know, it was developed and released by MITRE, but, you know, kind of funded by NSA. Can you talk a little bit about why it was important for NSA to invest in this?
Of course. As Peter was saying, you know, we've all been using MITRE ATT&CK for years to describe how different malicious cyber threat actors get into networks, spread around the networks. But at least at NSA, our mission really is to defend national security systems, Department of Defense networks, help support the defense industrial base. And the key there is to actually defend those networks. Just telling them how different actors are going to get into those networks is not enough. That's one part of the puzzle. But the other piece really is, what are the techniques to defend, to protect, detect, respond, and recover from those different adversarial techniques? And that's where D3FEND came in. So as soon as we heard about it, we jumped on the opportunity and said, this is something we want to develop, so that way all of those defenders won't have that experience that you had, where you're using the wrong word and can actually speak the same language and describe things in the same way. And we can communicate to our customers, to our partners better, for what they need to do to improve the security of their network.
So it was developed and released during COVID. It's now been a couple years since then. Peter, what has been the real world application of D3FEND? Who's using it, and what kind of feedback have you all gotten from the community to date?
So we get a lot of feedback from actually all over the world. So that the global aspect has been interesting. People have discovered it, and they're using it to organize their defenses and ask better questions. So we get emails and people communicating with us online about how they're using it. They're using it to design their defensive strategies and really have effectively a framework to talk about these defensive technologies. So we've seen folks from international governments, commercial industry across the sectors, ranging from defense to energy to financials, and their architects are using it to really make sense of a lot of complexity.
So it's, if I'm hearing correctly, it's not just the network architect, but also a little bit of the C-suite in terms of, you know, is that guiding budget decisions, or, you know, am I misunderstanding?
No, that's right. So one thing we found is that as we've gone out and applied it to even some MITRE sponsors, we found that just simply knowing what your investments are supposed to do and then comparing that to what they're configured to do has yielded incredible results. And some of them are, in fact, you know, it's sort of eye-popping. And you can then identify where one person thought that they had something, and it turns out they really didn't. And so having that sort of systematic approach to understanding what your investments should be doing lets you have those sorts of insights.
Yeah, I think that's really important. So Eric, how is NSA and the Department of Defense using the framework?
So NSA, that's a great question. NSA has been using D3FEND in primarily two ways. The first, as we were discussing before, for the cybersecurity advisories that go out publicly. We produce numerous ones every year. We describe the threat activity that people should be concerned about, but we also want to, in every single one of those publications, say, here are the mitigations that counter that activity. And that's where D3FEND has come in to really help us say, here are the ways that you can defend your networks. We describe it in text, but we'll also put the D3FEND codes in some of those advisories so people can easily get the gist of what they need to do, and there's no misunderstanding for what those defensive activities should be. The other primary way that NSA has been using D3FEND, and really quite successfully, I might add, is for the DoD Cybersecurity Architecture Review, what we call DODCAR. And that's where we look at individual networks within DoD. We'll look at the current architecture of that network. We'll take a look at what are the probable attack vectors that malicious actors could use to infiltrate the network, to spread laterally throughout the network, to go after whatever outcomes they're trying to achieve. And then the important part is really, what do we need to do to modify the architecture to improve their ability to detect or respond to those adversarial techniques? And that's where DFEND comes in. And usually we're describing the adversarial techniques with MITRE ATT&CK, and there's a natural mapping already from ATT&CK to DFEND, so we can do that analysis faster. And then even on the end results, we can communicate to our customers better and a little bit more granularly sometimes, where in the past we might say, oh, you need an EDR, an endpoint detection and response product on some of these systems. Now we can say, oh, you need an EDR product that has this specific capability to do, let's say, PowerShell event log analysis, because that's where you're missing a piece and an adversary could come in and do their malicious activities. And so now we can say that easily with DFEND, so that they know exactly what they need to do. They can look for the right products, the right capabilities, and truly improve the defense of their networks.
So it's being integrated into that process?
Exactly.
Okay. That's fantastic. Cool. So I think that as we were talking about this and I was thinking about it and researching, you know, everybody knows what MITRE ATT&CK is. And there's stickers and, you know, it's just really permeated throughout the community. And I think DFEND is still growing in terms of popularity. It's still very new. But also I think that there's sometimes a misperception that offense is sexy and defense is kind of boring. You know, I disagree. But I'm curious, you know, what have you seen in terms of adoption rates across the community? Is that growing? And, you know, if not, what are next steps?
So when we look at adoption, we have a number of sources that we track. One is sort of traffic to the website. And we get a pretty decent amount of traffic to the website that's been growing over time. So interest in it is not going down. And then we have some limited visibility there because most security people block the analytics, right? And then we also track activity on GitHub, contributions from folks. That's growing. And then we also have a community on Slack. We have a dedicated Slack workspace that anyone can join. And that's been growing significantly over time. So one thing we've realized is that, you know, the target audience for DFEND is these sort of security architects, engineers, and yes, there's intersection with operations, of course, and that's one of the key benefits of the framework, actually, is that it kind of lets the two different groups talk the same language. This target audience, you know, they're not like highly active on social media. Right. And in some cases, the work that they do is sensitive because they can't go and talk about their company or their bank's like sort security architecture. So one thing that we're looking towards for the future is how do we engage this community in a way that makes them comfortable with sharing insights so that we all get smarter. Right. So I'm very optimistic about, you know, solving that problem. And I think there's a lot of opportunity if we can get a little more openness, you know, with how the folks are using it.
Yeah, that's interesting. You know, I love to just let a tweet fly, but it sounds like that might not be the most effective way of communicating with them.
Right.
So, you know, you mentioned that, you know, DFEND is on GitHub. So I'm curious, you know, Eric, has NSA contributed to DFEND, you know, post-release? Are we supporting, you know, the evolution or the refinement of that framework?
Yes, of course. Great question. We have been supporting DFEND, you know, since before it was originally released. We've been working closely with the MITRE team supporting it, giving some refinements. And as it's been maturing, it's been including more and more defensive activities, and we've been suggesting more. We've been working with them on GitHub, but also behind the scenes through direct communication with Peter and his team.
Awesome. So if, you know, someone wants to contribute, how can an engineer, you know, or a network architect, like you mentioned, get involved?
So there's three main ways. First is we take emails, defend@mitre.org. It's on a website, D3FEND. You know, we receive a lot of emails there. We also have GitHub. It's github.com/defend.
Defend with three.
Defend with a three, right? We had to throw that in there. Yeah. And the other way too is we have a public Slack workspace, which is growing significantly. And, you know, people come in there from all across the world. Some vendors go in there and they talk about how they're using it, which is very cool to see. So those are the three main ways.
So speaking of three, what does the three in defend stand for?
So detection, denial, and disruption.
Okay. I can appreciate right. you condensing that. Awesome. Right. Well, as we're starting to wrap this podcast up, is there any final thoughts that you would want to share with the, no doubt, hundreds of thousands of people listening to this podcast right now?
Yes. You know, defend is, even though it's sort of a solving a basic problem, you can think of it like we're building a foundation on for a house. We're very excited about the future of it because with a really good foundation, we can do lots of really interesting things on top of it and build applications using the core components of defend. So there's where it is now, but then there's where it's going. And I'm very excited about that from a research and development perspective.
And similarly for NSA, I mean, we've been very happy with the growth that Defend has had to date. And as it matures further, you know, we're also very excited about the future for Defend to use it in more of our architecture reviews and to help the community communicate and collaborate better to really improve the defenses that we have.
Well, I think it's great. It really provides a level of standardization, specificity, and repeatability that I don't feel was previously available in terms of defensive measures in the community. So, Peter, thank you for your work. Eric, thank you as well. Thank you both for joining me here today. If you'd like to find the Defend framework, you can visit the website that Peter mentioned. You can also visit nsa.gov or follow us on Twitter @NSA Cyber. Thanks.